No one had to be woken by reveille this morning. We all knew that our new planes would be here at first light. How magnificent these gleaming new SE-5s are, freshly painted and without a single bullet hole. We'll be trying out these beauties in an hour, strafing trains at Luxembourg. The first pilot to catch any gunfire and mess up his fuselage loses the company betting pool. The morning sun formed a radiant prism as it turned my sparkling wings into a giant mirror. Even my guns were clean as I lined them up for their first devastating blows on the railway. No matter what catastrophes the war brings, I never cease to be amazed by the wonder of flight. While the war is hardly over, I can't help but spend many a moment each day reflecting on what it means to be a man with wings. Four of us are assigned today to escort a recon plane to Liège. Yet all I can think about is leaving the ground and relishing the infinite view. The surge of seven enemy aircraft sent the pilots of my sortie into a maze of a response. Our recon plane still needed its photos, but first we'd have to fight for its right to take them. Thank you. It may not be any great revelation, but winning certainly does beat the taste of defeat. The British have launched a sweeping drive from Amiens that continues to hearten us. The Luftstreitkraft is withering without leadership, and Ludendorff's boys are learning how to run backwards. We'll be giving the Hun infantry at Sarrebruckern an added shove when we strafe a road there this evening. If Ludendorff was as smart as we once thought he was, he'd have thrown in the towel by now. Since he obviously wasn't, we'd have to convince his men to make that decision for him. Guess who returned last night? Barclay. I think it was the scent of Otis's shepherd's pie that dragged him back. I should say, dragged her back. And her five puppies. None of us had any idea he was... Well, how does one say it gracefully? I mean, we knew he was a she, but not a she ready to bear offspring. One hell of a lively litter, too. While we were readying for our noon patrol to Saarburg, we couldn't keep any of them off the runway. With four planes on the lookout for Jerry, we reached Saarburg with hopes of hurrying home for one of Otis's tasty lunches. The five enemy fighters below us looked starved for something else. Barclay is certainly glad to be home. The way she is camping on our runway, you'd think she was getting ready to teach her pups the old Barclay barrel roll. We're all wagering on which of the Barclayettes does it first. After I place my bet, I'm off with one of the other boys for a little sightseeing at Sarrebruggen. Our pleasant afternoon patrol was about to turn hostile. Three triplanes and a Fokker D7 marked the presence of Jasta 26, here to break up our fun. Another cold-blooded casualty of the war. Farah's informant was found out. He was a lowly stenographer in the German quartermaster's office who didn't believe in the enemy's cause. Early this morning, they caught him wiring us news of an attack on our San Menehould base. His unwrapped body was just delivered to us by a Zeppelin. It splattered. My hands won't stop shaking. The war became a free-for-all when 7 D7s arrived to hammer San Menehould, even though they knew we'd been tipped off. my four-plane sortie had to ensure that our informant hadn't died in vain. found a new game. Recreation here has been sadly lacking, but the constant arrival of Yankee soldiers has brought baseball to Europe. I knocked one over the fence yesterday and Barkley went after it, all recovered from berthing. I plan to play another 9 innings when I return from my patrol over the Inn. With my fantasies wandering to the pitch at Lord's, I was caught off guard by 5 Huns from Yasta 35. Keeping an eye on each of my partners, I forgot about batting and got warmed up to fire. Farah says that this will be the most important month in the history of the air service. Not only are we to play a major role in the impending San Miguel offensive, we're to join a massive airstrike with all the other allies at month's end. Farah warns this is top secret, but the sortie could involve as many as 800 planes. We're bombing the Metz aerodrome at midday to foster our success. The struggling Jagdstaffeln stationed at Metz were still protected by unremitting Archie. There were plenty of hangars for us to hit, but only if we were crafty enough not to get hit ourselves. Why won't the Huns give up? Do they all want to die, or are they bent on making it as miserable as possible for us to win? Our own aerodrome was strafed this morning. I don't think I've ever seen so much steam blow out of Farah's ears. "Strafe the Meuse trenches until their bodies are reduced to pulp," he hollered. "Then strafe them again." Not sure the request is sane, but it is an order. I knew Farah would like nothing better than to see our planes cutting off the enemy's retreat. Hun soldiers were fleeing their trenches in droves, so we'd have to stop them dead in their tracks. Otis packed us ham and cheese sandwiches for our patrol today over the Argonne. When Holy Joe caught him feeding leftovers to Barclay last night, I was sure they were going to come to blows. Not so. Holy Joe put his arm around Otis and thanked him for making our lives better, then apologised for what all along has been a rather nasty stomach ulcer. The chaplain has an ulcer. War does bizarre things to men. The dense Argonne was colourfully alive with the first turning leaves of autumn. If our four-man sortie wanted to enjoy the view, we'd have to knock out the two oncoming fighters. Farrow's sending me and another chap to bust a shifty balloon at Aulnoy this afternoon. General Pershing's offensive at Saint-Mihiel has put the baseball game we'd scheduled on hold. Not to worry. The teams organised here will last long past the armistice. I couldn't believe the sole observer I was preparing to dismantle was protected by nothing more than loose anti-aircraft fire. I knew the enemy was in decline, but they couldn't be this bad off.